In fact, there's a sense in which Anselm really rejects every single one of these premises. That is to say, rejects one, rejects two, rejects five, rejects eight. And so I want to talk about some of the arguments he gives us in some detail. Anselm begins his analysis by taking this argument for fatalism and flipping it on its head. Let's again let P be a true proposition about an action you're going to take in the future. But this time, it's not just the proposition that you will do it. It's the proposition that you will do it freely. Now we can say, okay, God believed yesterday that you would do that thing freely tomorrow. God is omniscient after all, and you will do it freely tomorrow, so God believed that yesterday. Now, since God is omniscient, whatever God believes is true, and so if God believed it yesterday, it will be true. Moreover, because the past is necessary, it's a necessary truth that God believed yesterday that you would freely do that thing tomorrow. But now, it follows that it's a necessary truth that you will freely do that thing tomorrow. Huh. Well, wait a minute. It follows from that that you're going to do that tomorrow freely by necessity. So, now, here Anselm stops and says, don't we get an argument that proves the existence of freedom? That it's a necessary truth that you will do that tomorrow freely. We could also, although Anselm doesn't quite put it this way, use this as a way of saying, look, we've got a paradox here. Something has gone wrong. Because it looks like we get both necessity and freedom out of this. You will do that thing tomorrow freely. But it's a necessary truth that you will do it tomorrow. Because you will do it tomorrow freely, that entails that you'll do it tomorrow. So it's a necessary truth that you'll do it tomorrow. But it's also a necessary truth that you will do it freely tomorrow. And so it follows that you will act freely tomorrow. So we've got the conclusion that you will act freely tomorrow, and also that you will act by necessity tomorrow. But that's supposed to be a contradiction. At least, we can say, tomorrow you won't have any ability to do otherwise, but you will act freely, so maybe that itself is an argument against that principle of alternative possibilities. However it goes, it looks like one of those premises in the argument has to be false. One of those premises in that original fatalistic argument must be false if we can construct that alternative. Now, Anselm thinks that several of them are false, so let's take a look at the arguments. As Anselm puts it, there is no conflict whatsoever between a foreknowledge which entails a necessary occurrence and a free exercise of an uncoerced will. In other words, there cannot be any incompatibility between freedom of the will and some kind of necessity. But that means something's gone wrong in that argument. That is to say, one of those premises at least must be false. He thinks several of them are. So let's look at the details. First, and most obviously, Anselm rejects the principle of alternative possibilities. We really could use that variant argument of his to say we've got an argument now that we can have necessity and freedom at the same time. And so the idea has to be that you can be free without having any alternative possibilities open to you that you couldn't have done otherwise, and nevertheless you act freely. So we could already use that paradox that he's constructed as an argument against the principle of alternative possibilities, premise 8. But there are other ways of taking this as well, other reasons for rejecting it. Remember his definition of freedom of the will. Our freedom of the will is for making the right choice. And so freedom consists in our ability to preserve the rectitude of the will for its own sake, to be able to keep justice in the will, to keep our rightness of the will for the sake of that rightness. Well, if that's correct, then we don't need alternative possibilities. We don't have to have been able to do otherwise. Indeed, the freest being, the paradigm of freedom, is God. And yet God has no other options. God does what is right necessarily. God is necessarily good. God has no other options. There are no possibilities of God sinning, of God doing evil, and so on. And yet God acts freely. Well, if that's right, then freedom does not require alternative possibilities. You can be free even though it is impossible for you to do otherwise. There are other reasons besides God for thinking this is true. There are human reasons as well. If we become more and more corrupted in our nature, if we become weaker and weaker of will, do we become more free or less free? All sorts of options open to us that would never have been possibilities for us before. We would never have dreamt of doing any of those things. Are we now freer No, we're less free. We're more enslaved to sin, he would say. The person who is freer is the person who manages to stay on the right path without those distractions, without those other things that would lead you astray, even being possibilities. And so he says, look, even at the level of human freedom, this idea that you need alternative possibilities, and in a sense, the more alternative possibilities, the freer, that's completely wrong. Actually, that's not how it goes at all. Freedom is a matter of having the power to do the right thing for the right reason. And it's a power to maintain that ability. That is not something that requires alternative options. It is not something that requires an ability to do otherwise. So he clearly rejects premise 8. But he doesn't stop there. He thinks there are other problems with the argument as well. First of all, he agrees with Boethius. He rejects premise 1. He says God doesn't know this yesterday or at any other point in time because God isn't in time. God is outside of time. God is in something we could vaguely think of as an eternal present. God is outside of space and time, like a being on a mountaintop, looking down at the road below the mountain, seeing all of it at once. God surveys past, present, future, all in one go. And so we don't think of God's knowledge or God's causal activity or anything else as taking place at a point in the road. So already to say God believed something yesterday is to make a mistake. God and God's states of mind, God's beliefs, God's willings, and so on, are all outside of time. They don't happen at points of time. So this notion of historical necessity can't possibly apply to them. Anselm also rejects premise 5. That is to say, he denies that if A is now necessary, and if necessarily if A then B is now necessary. It's not easy to reason about this kind of historical necessity. And to understand that, we need to think of a kind of example here that's going to show where things go astray. Anselm points out that the fact that something is now necessary, because it's in the past, does not entail that it was then necessary, or that it was necessary from the point of view of someone even earlier than that, nor does it imply that it's necessary from God's point of view outside time, in some deeper metaphysical sense. God can perfectly well, from outside of time, let's say, recognize that there are contingent truths, can create a universe in which there is contingency. God will, from that vantage point outside time, be able to recognize these things as contingent truths. So let's plug that into the picture. God believes, yesterday, that this thing, which is a contingent truth, is true. Well, God believed that in the past, can't change that now, so God's belief in the past must be necessary. But now, anything God believes has to be true, so it's got to be true, this contingent truth, we knew that. But now, since it's something that follows necessarily from a truth that is now necessary, that God believed it yesterday, we now get that it's necessary, it's now necessary, this contingent truth. Well, wait a minute, something's gone wrong. This now necessary business, then, can't contradict contingency. And so it looks as if there's a conflict here, but in fact what's going on, now partly we could just say, yeah, this idea of historical necessity, this after-the-fact necessity is weird and it doesn't really contradict contingency at all. That's to really merge this into something like that Occam's solution or the Molinist solution. But we could also say, look, there's something preposterous then about what's going on here. We said at the outset, this is a metaphysically contingent truth. Nothing that's happened here should deny that. And so what it amounts to is this. What we've got, Anselm says, in this picture of historical necessity is a necessity that, as it were, bobs along in time. And he says that's really dependent entirely on the arrow of time. The whole idea is that I can't change the past. That's what it means for the past to be necessary. But look, later, I mean, yeah, I won't be able to change what's going on today, but today I can change what's going on today. And so similarly, yeah, you can't change what's going on in the past now, but you could have changed it then, and you could have done things even earlier that would have affected it and changed it. So in short, the fact that there's a kind of necessity that is dependent on the arrow of time and one's position in time has nothing to do with this deeper sense of necessity. But that's exactly what premise 5 is trying to do. It's trying to tie historical necessity, the kind that is bobbing along with the arrow of time, to this underlying metaphysical necessity, the necessity of that conditional, that if A, then B, and draw conclusions ultimately about real metaphysical necessity from this bobbing along historical kind of necessity. And that is just illegitimate. There are two completely different kinds of necessity at stake here. And so premise five fails because it's a weird mixture of a metaphysical necessity and this highly variable sort of historical necessity that depends on the arrow of time and our position in time. You can't mix the two. It's like oil and water. What we're doing is taking two very different kinds of necessity and blending them together in a principle that might be fine if this were all metaphysical necessity, but doesn't work at all for this arrow of time type necessity.